We now come to our fourth plenary session, and we're going to be looking at the topic religion and spirituality in the 21st century. Our panel discussion will be chaired by Mark Jocumsen of the Spiritual Assembly of Baha'i here in Toowoomba. Mark is a member of the Toowoomba Interfaith Working Group, and our speakers will be Associate Professor Keith Thompson, Associate Professor of Law and the Associate Dean at the Sydney School of Law, University of Notre Dame, and the Venerable Wu Chin, who is well known to all of us from Pure Land Learning, Pure Land Learning College Association. So, Keith and Venerable Wu Chin, would you like to come up and sit in the hot seat, please? And would you please welcome them? And I'll now hand over to Mark, and each speaker will speak for 20 minutes. Don't forget, I've got my signs, and I'll hold them up, and Mark will chair the meeting, and I'll worry about the timekeeping.
Thank you. Welcome, friends. It's a great pleasure to be here today to be able to chair this part of this plenary session number four. My name's Mark Jocumsen. As Richard mentioned, I'm on the local spiritual assembly of the Baha'is of Toowoomba. Unfortunately, due to work commitments, I have been unable to participate in the conference to date, but it's fantastic to see so many people here who are interested in these topics that probably don't get enough airplay when we come look in our modern society. So before further ado, I'd like to invite Associate Professor Keith Thompson to present his talk. And we, give him a round of applause, please.
Well, thank you to Toowoomba, the interfaith community, and Mark for the opportunity to speak today. I have just put a few slides on the board, and I would like to just speak to them briefly.
Is that right?
So I put this one away?
Yeah.
Thank you. 4/5 of the world's population are profoundly religious, and the world is becoming more religious. The liberal West has its head in the sand if it thinks the world can be managed and governed without reference to religion, religious belief, and religious observance. The most famous promoters of the thesis that religion was destined to die away in the blinding Enlightenment were Karl Marx and Peter Berger. Karl Marx, you'll remember, referred to religion as the opium of the people. And I've put the whole quote there. Religious suffering, he said, is at the one and the same time the expression of real suffering and a protest against real suffering. Religion is the sigh of the oppressed creature, the heart of a heartless world, and the soul of soulless conditions. It is the opium of the people. The abolition of religion as the illusory happiness, he claimed, of the people is the demand for their real happiness. I thought I would put the full quote up so that you just didn't get the opium bit that we all mock him with. That doesn't mean that he's still not worth mocking, and I'll comment on that a little more. Peter Berger, there's Karl Marx, just so you know who we're talking about. Peter Berger, a very renowned sociologist who passed away earlier this year, he wrote a famous text in the 1960s called The Sacred Canopy, in which he proposed that religion would die away, and he did it from an entirely secular, non-political point of view. But he completely withdrew from that thesis in the 1990s. Now, I'm not saying he did that just because he saw that Marxist communism had also failed about that time, but he completely retreated from that. I'm talking about religion and its critics at the moment, as you will appreciate. I want to talk for a moment about the spiritual nature of man with just a couple of quotes. This first one from Pierre Teilhard de Chardin. He said famously, and there have been various restatements of this by others, we are not human beings having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. And then a different one. I don't know if you recognize, that's Pierre, but if you remember this movie that Hollywood put together, where the basic thesis was that they had weighed a body at time of death and immediately after death, and it was 21 grams lighter because something had left. Do you remember that thesis? That was, the movie was put together with those directors, and it starred Sean Penn and Naomi Watts. The persecution of otherness presents as a part of our inheritance as evolved creatures featuring a selfish gene. The religious, spiritual, or transcendent take on this insight is that we are intended by our Creator to transcend our base natures by the exercise of the spiritual power which He has planted in us as well. Celebration of and respect for diversity is only possible through reason, but all human beings intuitively sense its possibility because of their spiritual or transcendent nature. The atrocities of World War II caused a collective sigh in mankind and enabled us to achieve a brief consensus on toleration. I don't think we ever got beyond toleration to respect. And I think that the toleration really only lasted from 1943-45 through until the 1980s in the United States. We do not appear to be able to sustain that consensus without the calamity of universal conflict. Martha Nussbaum, and I've got a picture of Martha here. Martha Nussbaum has suggested that we need to relearn in every succeeding generation liberty of conscience. We need to learn the lessons of freedom of conscience and religion, which were almost forced upon us by World War II. Her insight also suggests that all educational curricula teach the dual nature of man and the essentiality of cooperation and reciprocity. Now, there are more modern critics of liberty of religion. I don't know if you have heard of the concept of intersectionality. It has two famous advocates, and I'm going to tell you their names, but I don't necessarily want to popularize what they are teaching, but Laurie Beeman and Elizabeth Shackman Heard propose that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and its offspring covenants, which I've there put on the board where they relate to freedom of religion, liberty of conscience, which achieved international law status during the 20th century, which I say by now we should be developing into an international rule of law system operating in accordance with principles of subsidiarity. But our new international rule of law baby is threatened with infanticide. Humankind seems destined to return to type and reinstate the coercive legal systems of the past. These range from the corrupted caliphate of the Taliban, ISIS and Daesh, through the laicist secular regimes in Europe, which strive to achieve enforced homogeneity, and through to a Buddhist oligarchy in Myanmar. All faiths have their challenged places. Mine has the Mountain Meadows Massacre of 1857. Mankind has not lost its belief in God at the genesis of the 21st century, but mankind has lost some of its faith in institutional religion. I've got pictures of these people on the board, and I will tell you just a little bit about them. Laurie Beeman has written articles about deep equality. She would abolish all of the human rights in favour of her concept of deep equality. At a conference last year when I was speaking about religious liberty, Elizabeth Shackman Heard got up and called out to me that I was a racist. But then I read the following week in the newspaper internationally that Martin Castro, who was the chair of the Religious Civil Liberty Commission, said that freedom of religion, liberty of conscience, and those who promoted it were using those phrases as they're said. They stand for nothing except hypocrisy, so long as they remain code words for discrimination, intolerance, racism, sexism, homophobia. In fact, in some of the reports, he said religious liberty is just code for racism, sexism, and homophobia, which is a little frightening. It's a form of political correctness. Why is institutional religion, or why is it losing its ability to adequately communicate its message of holiness, purification, and sanctification? That noble striving has been obscured in many institutions, I think, because they have been afraid to purge themselves of unholy members. It takes courage to resist the allegation that excommunication is uncompassionate. When we encounter cancer in our own bodies during medical checkups, we don't hesitate to excise it. If religious institutions are to preserve the credibility of their holiness message, they must move promptly to remove unworthy members from positions of responsibility, and they must develop wise strategies to cut off their heretics as well. But in making that observation, I affirm my allegiance to the principle that human law has no right to interfere in religious worship and other religious practice unless that religious worship or practice infringes on the rights and liberties of others in an objectively harmful way. Now, the consequence, and I know what I've said is controversial, the consequence of my observation is that the excommunication of a member from a church for breach of its high standards of personal conduct should not by itself dictate the exile of that same individual from gainful employment or from position in the public square. But in my view, and I've thought about it a lot, if religious institutions are to retain their credibility, they have to prove that they mean what they say about standards of conduct. How much time do I have, Richard? 5. Just a couple of other things that I thought I would reflect here with you. We don't seem to be able to achieve nirvana, however we characterize it, without divine help. And here's my summary comments. Mankind has not lost its faith in God. Mankind has lost some of its faith in institutional religion because we have not been able to communicate adequately, non-hypocritically, our message of holiness, purification, and sanctification. And we haven't purged ourselves adequately of people that don't live that example. Justice Dyson Hayden, formerly of the High Court, delivered the inaugural PM Glynn address in Adelaide last month. He spoke of the fact that Patrick McMahon Glynn was responsible for the words in our Constitution which speak about humbly relying on the blessings of Almighty God. Hayden reflected that that is not what modern elites think. The public voices of modern elites, he said, are not humble. They conceive themselves to have entitlements and rights, not blessings, and they do not feel any gratitude to Almighty God for their entitlements and rights. Referring to recently publicised words such as burn churches, not gays, crucify no voters, Mr. Hayden questioned why it was acceptable for one element of public opinion to call for the physical destruction of places of worship and for the death of those who worship in them. That is treated as merely routine, apparently fit to pass without comment, but it is not seen as all right for those who worship to publicly state the beliefs they hold and to argue whether on narrowly religious or ethical or even utilitarian grounds for or against particular policy positions in the general debate. Some want to destroy faith itself, he warned. The modern elites are tyrants of tolerance. He spoke of the howling down of the free exercise idea that is entrenched in section 116 of the Constitution and complained that modern elites do not demand tolerance, they demand unconditional surrender. I've reflected on his lecture. I'm not going to read you any more of it. It's fairly thought-provoking, but it is a little bit negative. My end note is that we remain spiritual creatures, that the world is actually becoming more religious. In Australia, it is easy for people to put their head in the sand and not realise that, to think that we are becoming, or that religion is going out of fashion and that we are going to be persecuted like the ancient Christians were in lions' arenas. There may be some persecution, but my sense is that the debate in Canberra is going to be more healthy than that, and I was pleased at the morning tea break for Natalie to tell me of some of the things that Senator Smith said yesterday as the debate opened in Canberra to suggest that there is going to be much more reflection on what will make a good outcome for religion in Australia to come. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Associate Professor. That was a fascinating speech and certainly very topical at this point in time. No doubt some of us have all felt that religion has copped a rough end of the stick in our society over the last period of time, and that's everyone's had a chance, has been forced to reflect on the role of religion and institutions in how we make those moral decisions in our lives. And while everyone's no doubt got different thoughts, I think it's important that the message gets out there that we acknowledge that institutions, the institutional faith and religion has got a lot to offer society, and the fact that there might be some individuals that are challenged and are unable to hold up to those high standards set by faiths and cause, that reputation or those issues around hypocrisy, we need to separate that and still appreciate the goodness and the teachings that are professed by the major faiths in the world, all the faiths. Moving on, I'd now like to introduce my wonderful good friend Venerable Wu Chin from the Pure Land Learning College Association, and we give her a round of applause, please, for her talk.
Welcome to this conference, and today when we receive the topic of religion and spirituality in the 21st century. It sets us thinking, you know, looking at what is currently happening in the world today. I had one Venerable who just came back from China telling me about how when she tried to order breakfast, you know, with some friends at one of the eating places, and she couldn't make the payment because they didn't bring a mobile phone with them. And they don't accept cash, you know, so what they had to do was, luckily, a nice man offered, you know, say, I, you can use my phone to pay, you know, and they gave him cash instead. You know, so when we look at the advancing technology, and we are already moving into the, you know, the 21st century, and we are there now, what's going on, you know, forward from the rest of this century with all this advancing technology? And if you go to the supermarket and places where agencies, especially the government or even the banks, everything is going automated. You know, I was sharing with one of at our friendship dinner and asking our friends, you know, in the audience, and said, you know, if all the robots and the machines are doing the job, then what are we going to do next? You know, what are we humans? What are we going to do? Of course, we are the one with the intelligent mind, you know, and we are the ones, humans, you know, who created the computers and all the technology. So if they are all doing our work, then what is there for us to do? You know, so, you know, we started thinking. And then we said, won't we have more time to enjoy life? You know, of course, we will still have work to do. But we will have more time to work on ourselves, looking into ourselves, studying the scriptures, and living life. And so we would, when we would look at it that way, then we think, oh, life isn't so bad. Of course, we heard our brother, he did mention a very, you know, very true fact about how, you know, when people are not following or learning religions anymore, because we religious people are not doing a good example. You know, we are not a good example. Of course, we have to admit that as humans, you know, we do have our flaws and weaknesses. We are not perfect people. But as we read the scriptures of what the faith has given us, we would know how weak we are and how much, you know, things or flaws we still have to fix in ourselves. And we also understand that, you know, as religious representative, you know, whether we are clergies or whether we are lay people, when people know that you are of a certain religion, whatever we do or say, we will be labeled as that's that religion, you know, people of that religion think and do that, you know, even if it's only one or two people doing that, while the rest are not doing that, but people tend to have that label attached to it. So, you know, when I heard what our brother said, you know, I do feel sad. Yes, that's true. So it sort of reminded us again and again that, you know, what we have obtained or learned from our religion, I guess we just have to digest it and practice it, you know, as much as we can. And one of our Venerable, I was looking at this topic with her, and we said, actually, the important thing, looking into this 21st century of about religion and spirituality, is actually going back to having that sacred love or God's love and passing it on. Can we take maybe a couple of minutes and close our eyes? You know, all of us just close our eyes and let us try to stay relaxed and imagine the city or the country that we are in. What kind of relationship would people have if this world is to be a wonderful place to be in? I hope you don't fall asleep. Can we imagine, you know, if this we are going to this 21st century, forgetting about the technology and all the social media that we are all distracted from, you know, by. Let's just look at people's relationship. You know, what kind of world or city we will be living in when this place is a wonderful place? You know, would parents and children, you know, love one another? You know, you can see smiling faces of father, mother, daughter, sons, you know, looking at each other, smiling and talking, communicating. So in a family unit, if we were to imagine in our hearts, our minds, in a wonderful world that we are looking at, in this world, you know, the parents and children will be communicating to each other. And the children will be able to face all the difficulties in the society and any hardships that may come their way. Why? Because they have love. You know, love is the thing that keeps us strong and that helps us to tide over any difficulties. Okay, now the vision, let us continue to, you know, imagine. How about the relationship between friends? What does it look like, you know, in this wonderful world? You know, where people are very trustworthy and kind. You know, the friends and friends, you do have trust and you are connected to each other through sincerity. You know, and, you know, things like humming or killing or even fighting for benefits is not in that type of scenario. You know, what is there is friendship, sincerity, and kindness. Okay, so let us open our eyes. You know, so how many of us can imagine such a wonderful world? Or we try, or at least we try. When we look at this, this kind of perfect scenario, you know, which we always learn about in the scriptures, why is it that, you know, God's love or the divine's love cannot be passed or assimilated into the society or passed on, you know, to the various people? You know, we do look at what's happening in the world today where, you know, earth, natural resources are being depleted every day because we wanted more wealth, a better standard of living. And then more and more, because economy has to thrive and they keep taking from the earth resources. And what's happening, I'm not one who study about what's going on, the current news, but we do know that the earth's resources, because it's depleting, there are climate changes and many things going on around. But in order to go back to this kind of world that we just try to imagine that if it's a wonderful place to be living in, we all have to go back to this God's love and scriptures. And we have to study the scriptures. So if people do have a religion or faith that they can rely on, or, okay, to be fair, you say, I have not chosen a faith, so where do I belong? There are many great philosophers in the world, you know, who have said the same teachings as what the founder of many great religions have said. And the purpose of each is actually to help us find the goal in life. To return back to our original true self nature, where all this rich love that comes from inside ourselves, you know, so that's where it all comes. But we can't access it because of the discriminations and attachments that we still have. You know, let's say two very good friends are together, but because one wants something that the other wants, you know, and if there's only that one thing there, but two people want the same thing, you know, and they didn't want to take it like fairly, but they try to gain it in an unfair way. And we find that then that's where the conflict and the fighting starts because we are not able to let go. You know, someone asked me a question about what the calligraphy writing that we've been giving out, what did it mean? It actually means that everything in this world, it has a form, but it's actually empty in nature. We all realize from the teachings that we come here empty-handed, and ultimately we will live this world empty-handed. You know, so there are many teachings in the scriptures that we are still I'm still pressurized by the minutes. Okay, there are many teachings in the scriptures that we have to go back into. And only by studying these scriptures deep in, you know, spending hours and days and years on it, that we are able to go back to find that true unconditional love that all of us do have. So if we can all go back to that, and I'm sure religious representative and teachers and lay people will all become stronger, and we'll find that the teachings, if we are all living happy lives, why would not, you know, other people want happy lives? When they see that we are happy, I'm sure people will start wanting to know, how are you doing this that you can be have such a happy family? What are you doing that you can be so happy? So when we all, everyone start learning, you know, and we start that influence, start going out like ripple effect, I'm sure even in this 21st century, more and more teachings of the religion and of great philosophies will thrive, it will thrive and become flourishing, and people will be happy. If this is not the way, then there'll be more suffering for the humanity. So we just have to go back to the religious texts and start learning and practicing. So I guess that's my little sharing that I have with all of you. And later, if we have more questions or comments, my brother, Dharma brother, Venerable U Tao, will be here to help to answer the questions as well. Thank you. Amitabha.
Thank you very much, Venerable Wu Chin. It's always wonderful to hear that consistent message from the Buddhists, the message of love and the importance of studying the Holy Scriptures and seeking to apply those in our lives such that we can achieve at least some measure of the happiness that it appears that many of the people in the Buddhist community enjoy. So now we come to a time where we've got the opportunity to ask some questions.
We have.
We have.
We have, and I have the first question.
Oh, okay.
Not often that I do this. Keith, you talked about excommunication and separation of brethren and sistren. And how, and I have a difficulty with that, because history has told us that whenever, and I'm talking specifically about the Christian Church, whenever the Christian Church has sought to exercise excommunication, it usually comes in the form of an abuse of power. And to the point where, in fact, it's so counterproductive, I can understand why it is no longer used in many places. So what are your thoughts on that? How do you see that, the difficulty between abuse of power and excommunication?
I expected to be questioned on this, which is why I put it out there.
We didn't go in cahoots, I can assure you.
No, that's fine. I didn't expect the abuse of power comment. I expected the uncompassionate comment. My expectation when it comes to church, I used the word excommunication to polarise and make you think. What I'm really talking about is transparent and public discipline when there has been public offence. If there has been private offence, then I think that the discipline can be private. But when it's been public and the institution has been shamed vicariously by its minister, its employee, its leader, then I think if the institution is to retain its integrity and be able to preach with credibility its message, as I said, of holiness, sanctification, and purity, then it needs to take some action. I do not believe that it is part of the religion of love, which I also espouse, that such people should be forever cut off from fellowship. In fact, in my own faith, where there is a fairly strong disciplinary tradition, those who are excommunicated, that word is still used, are not forbidden to attend or to participate in the congregation, but they know that they have lost their authority and that there will be a process of repentance, we call it, before they can be reinstated. Now, there are people within my own faith that think that is harsh, but I think it's necessary. I think that is part of love, that we do not pretend that people are all, that everything is hunky-dory when it's not. When there is need for reformation, I think it is part of the discipline of love. Discipline, after all, is another word that comes from discipleship. And it is, that word expects that there should be some discipline. Does that answer, Richard? Thank you.
I remember a number of years ago, an Anglican priest said to me, I'm a retired minister, he said, your sacrament of communion is not any good because you're not rightly ordained. But your baptism's all right because even a heretic can baptize. And I took that quite well because I believe in freedom of speech. And to me, it seems like freedom of speech means two things. I have the right to be insulted, but there's a responsibility. I have the duty to try to be kind. But on the other side, I do question whether we've become a almost crushing the freedom of speech because you can't say this to me because it's going to hurt my feelings. And I'm really concerned about that in our society. In certain universities around the world, someone who has unpopular ideas will be basically pushed out of the university by, I guess you'd call them left-wing fascists. And so I bring up the question, I'd like a little more elucidation about what you think freedom of speech means.
It's a good question. Really what you're asking in our context about is how we define heresy. Because I do believe in freedom of speech. I think one cannot speak freely unless one can think freely, and there is no point to associating freely unless we can think freely and speak freely as well. They are, those three freedoms, a compound in one. But when an institution accepts membership from, and when someone applies for membership in an institution, consenting to and knowing what the rules of that institution is, I think it is reasonable for that institution to exercise some discipline. Now, I've had a lot of people say to me, that's harsh, Keith, but I like to make the employer analogy. If I'm an employer, and let's say I'm selling computers, let's say I'm an IBM computer salesman, and my employee takes a brief from one of my competitors. I'll choose one that's no longer in existence. There was a computer company years ago called Wang. Let's say my employee starts to sell Wang computers when I have contracted with that employee to sell mine exclusively. Am I, as an employer, allowed to discipline that employee for that breach of the contract? I think there's an analogy there. Now, I'm not going to take it all the way, and it is for the individual institution to divine what loyalty to the institution is. But I say again, as a matter of principle, if the institution is to retain its public integrity and it says we stand for this and does nothing about breaches of that principle, then they may as well employ the Wang computer salesman and not care if he badmouths their products. Yes. Yes. Well, I think that free speech is fine. I mean, there is a great difference between the way free speech is spoken about in the United States, where the only thing that is off limits is, and I use an example, yelling fire in a crowded picture theatre. There are other things, short of that, that do damage society. For me, the most significant difference there is a case that happened in Canada called Keegstra, where a virulent anti-Semite was teaching high school, and he told the students and he examined them on spouting back to him his anti-Semitic rhetoric. It went to the Supreme Court of Canada, and they acknowledged that probably in the United States he would have been allowed to do that in the name of the United States version of freedom of speech, but that was off limits in Canada because it crossed the line. I think it would cross the line here too, and I think it is appropriately prescribed, but I don't think all free speech, I mean, nobody would disagree that yelling fire in a crowded picture theatre when there was no fire, that is irresponsible. But we could talk about that, where you draw the line, a lot more. But does that answer that part of the question? Thank you.
I have a question to the Venerable Wu Chin. Thank you very much for your presentation. And I was particularly taken by your emphasis on being an example. That's how we best communicate our beliefs, not so much with direct words, but by the way we live our faith. And I was just wondering that in this current 21st century, where anonymity seems to be getting more and more prized, particularly on the World Wide Web, when everybody seems to be anonymous, which gives them not so much freedom, but license to be able to exercise the extremes of what they see as free speech, which basically is just an excuse to criticize others. And my question is in relation also to what was in a previous session with our friend the Turban Man. Thank you very much for that, by the way. That was a great presentation. And I was thinking about what he said about wearing the turban alters one's behavior or focuses one's behavior because that is a symbol that you're displaying. And I notice that you are wearing a particular outfit, a mode of dress, and I'm just wondering whether you see that as an emblem of your faith, which actually helps you to then practice your faith in a public situation. The other question is, are you ever tempted to go civilian? where, in fact, you would not be identified, and so maybe you have a little bit more freedom to be less cautious.
Thank you, George. When you say the experience of going civilian, I had that experience, actually, wearing but my head is shaved, I can't grow hair in, like, minutes, you know, or I mean, like, in, you know, like everyone else, like, in a very short time. We had to go to China. Maybe I should stand, sorry. Venerable Master had wanted us to go to China to learn a morals and virtues program. And while we were in China, we were asked to, like, tone down your religious, you know, appearance. And what we had to do was we couldn't wear what we normally wear, our uniform. We had to put on just normal, you know, tops and pants. You know, so that's what I did. I feel, yeah, I'm trying to blend in with the rest of people with, you know, a long vest. So, you know, it's something like what I usually wear, but in a different color, cream color. And at that time, it was hundreds of people who are attending that same one-week program. And I think we still got spotted out, you know, by the local Chinese people. They still knew that, are you a Buddhist Venerable, you know, I was like, yes, you know, yeah, then, you know, and the last day we finished the program, I was so happy, I thought, oh, I can put on my uniform again, you know, that's what I'm used to doing. Yeah, I guess in a way, putting on the turban or even the uniform or even for the any of the faith, you know, the clergy, so having our own robes and it does remind us of who we represent. you know, I have to admit that, you know, there's many times that, you know, I feel bad that I'm wearing this, but I'm not doing as good as what, you know, our teacher is doing. But we do know that when we have this symbol or appearance, it does immediately remind people that you are of this faith, and we remind ourselves that we are of this faith as well. And what we do and what we say to people, others are going to associate this with our religion. You know, definitely, you can't escape from that, you know. So this is something that probably you can say this is also our discipline, you know, helping us to be more disciplined, and we have to constantly remind ourselves. Was there another question that I missed about the... Okay, thank you.
Covered it well. I have a Muslim friend, Venerable Wu Chin, who likes it when I appear in full rig, which I'm not in today. But his line is, you must be proud of your religion. Be proud of your faith, is what he constantly reminds all of us who know him well. And you know, be proud because he is proud of his. And I think that's something to worth keeping in mind.
Good afternoon. Sorry, good morning. This question is for Venerable Wu Tong. I see that Pure Land has been successful in bridging different faiths together. How would you encourage others to do the same? Thank you.
Sorry, we have borrowed your mic, Reverend Tutin's mic. So he said this is a very important question that we have to look into deeply as to how we are going to go about doing this promoting interfaith harmony.
这个鼓励大家呢，主要是我们发现问题。 必须要面对问题来解决这个问题，这个是鼓励大家互相学习多元文化、多元宗教的一个推动力量。
Okay, in general, when we have to try to understand where our individual or even our group's problems, where it lies, in order to be able to understand, we have to understand that first, in order to be able to know how we move forward onto this journey.
刚才这个听到各位发言啦，讲到有关言论自由啦，其他方面的那么这个都是大家呢，把自己心里的话，把自己心里的疑问讲出来，这个就是。
One way to do that is also to step out of, like, you know, the comfort zone, to come into contact with people of diverse faith. And like what we are doing here, we were all discussing and talking about various topics to understand and to understand where each other's perspective is lying. Yeah.
所谓言论自由，就是佛教讲的这个第一个不妄语，就是不欺骗人，第二个就是不恶口，讲话那个口气要温和，不能凶恶；第三个，不挑拨这个族群之间的感情；第四个呢，不。 不用一些美丽的谎言来欺骗人，这个就是我们言论自由的前提，就是我们讲的话 不去伤害别人。
Okay, so Venerable Tao is actually talking about when we are having the freedom of speech, we also have to, like, if we can, you know, follow the four principles of no lying, meaning what we say is the truth, and we do not hurt others with our lies. Secondly, is we should not say harsh words, as in knowing that it will hurt the other person. If we knew that, then we should not say, because I have freedom of speech, then I can say what I like, you know, to hurt the other person. So we should not do that. The third is no bearing tales. Is we should not try to say words that will create dissension between or separation between groups of people. And finally, no enticing speech, as in no sweet talking. You know, we should be sincere in the way we interact with others.
所以要推动我们多元文化的学习啊，释迦牟尼佛做一个示现给我们看。那佛的弟子啊，经典都是佛的学生有问题提出来问。 请问老师，为他老师为学生解答，针对他的问题解答，记录下来就是一部经。那么每一个人的问题都不一样啊，每个人现在要知道的事情也不一样啊，所以啊，佛教经典这么多啊，就是这么来的啊。因此啊，我们要推动这个多元文化的学习啊，我们就是把心里的疑问、面对的问题啊。 常常提出来互相交流，互相这个讨论，那么进一步得到一个结论来化解这些问题。
Venerable Tao mentioned about how when we are interacting with people of various faith or wanting to do this dialogue, we have to. Each of us have to go back to our own scriptures and study the teachings. And when we look for, when we have questions, we need to look for answers. We can like start by asking our teachers. You know, just like in our scriptures, all the teachings that come about from Buddhism started because the students have questions and the teacher, who is the Buddha, answered the question. So if one can look within our scriptures for the answers, and also have dialogue with people who are different from our faith, and continue to learn from them, we would be able to find the answers that we need as well.
哦，以上这个回答啊，如果还有问题，我们可以下次再讨论啊。Okay,
I hope this could be to help you to start you know, looking at this question, and that if there are further questions, we could have more time to dialogue afterwards or later. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
谢谢。
Friends, I believe we are, Richard, am I correct in that we're running, that concludes our time for
you
discussion?
You are very correct.
Very correct.
So correct it's not funny.
I think it might be. Before we close, I'd like us all to put a really warm round of applause for Associate Professor Keith Thompson and for Reverend Wu Chin and the other Reverend. Thank you so much for your wisdom and insights. And I wish everyone a very... yeah, enjoyable and interesting remainder of the conference.
Would you please thank Mark for chairing the meeting, or chairing this session. In the conversation, I was reminded of the four-way test of the Rotary International. Is it, the first two I can always remember, is it the truth? And the second one, is it fair to all concerned? And I think those two really encapsulate a lot of what we've been talking about this morning. And I can see a Rotarian nodding at me, so I'm saying the right things, which is great. It's now time for lunch. We resume at 1 p.m.